This new doctor is already up to speed with the adventures of time travel. He's seen off the Sycorax, canoodled with Cassandra, and wrestled with a werewolf. But this is one encounter he really didn't see coming.
Hello, Sarah Jane.
It's a massive universe, but a small world.
So it's just for that little moment.
Yes, indeed.
Thank you.
It's the 23rd of August 2005, and Elisabeth Sladen is shooting her first scene on Doctor Who for almost 30 years.
It's like my past life is running through my mind at the moment, and it's embarrassing with what clarity it comes back, actually.
Roll, please.
When I hear her voice, it's sort of 27 years ago when I'm eating cheese on toast with the family watching Doctor Who as a kid.
Action!
We need to run.
What have you done?
A lot of people will be quite amazed to see her. It's like she hasn't aged.
Cut!
The mood on set is just totally Doctor Who.
Liz, just let David slam the door before you arrive.
Everyone is enjoying being here. That feels totally the same.
David, can you squeeze a bit longer on the sonicking for me?
It's just bigger. In front of the camera, you just get the feeling it's the same. Makeup, wardrobe, lovely.
We need to run.
Where is he? What have you done?
Cut.
And for Liz's first shot, I think...
Welcome back, Sarah.
Well, I've just done my first scene this morning with David. A tiny little scene. Asking him what he's done with K9. And some running.
Action! And cut. Good for me.
I'm just cut.
The smiles are muted.
Honestly. We had to do the running again and again and again, so no difference there then.
Look at that smile.
Except this time, I had a different doctor, but it felt the same.
From her arrival in 1973...
How do you do, Miss Smith?
Hello.
..to her departure in 76...
Don't forget me.
Don't you forget me.
My doctor.
Liz Sladen appeared as Sarah Jane with two doctors in 18 adventures, becoming one of the most popular assistants of all time.
What made Sarah Jane absolutely real was the performance of Elisabeth Sladen.
What did you do?
Ask me later. Come on.
She just made her a genuine human being.
Please, don't die.
The Doctor was kind of very paternal, looked after his companions. But when Sarah Jane came along, she didn't need looking after.
Oh, Doctor, kindly don't be so patronising. Now, what is it really?
It's a Rondium sensor.
She was an independent woman. She knew her own mind.
Why do you ask so many questions?
Because I'm a journalist.
What Liz Sladen brought to it was a sort of really down-to-earth charm.
Women's liberation, Your Majesty. We women don't let men push us around.
It's not like that on Peridot.
It was wonderful to finally see what a companion should really, really be like.
If you're going back, then I'm coming with you.
I can do with all the help I can get.
The companion should want to be there, should want to be having adventures, should think, my God, I live in a spaceship, we travel through time.
Doctor!
So that's why Sarah Jane was so perfect.
Well done, Sarah. Just like a jelly man out of a flying trapeze. Come on.
As a fan, it felt absolutely brilliant. Me and Phil Collinson, when we met Liz Sladen to go and have dinner with her, we were like such fanboys.
After you?
Mm-mm. I'm going home, and I'm going by taxi.
She was a little bit cautious of us, I think because she was worried that we might be doing a sort of skit or taking the mickey out of Sarah Jane.
I thought, well, if they just want Sarah for a quick gag, I can't do it.
I'll make you an offer. I'll take you home.
Literally, I think she thought, like, we wanted her to walk past in the background as a sort of in-joke.
How can I refuse?
I love her, I really do, and I just didn't want to do that.
And we were sitting there going, no, it's real, it's like a whole episode where you're really important and there's lots of emotion and drama.
I was told the plot and it was such a gift. I was quite overwhelmed, actually.
The main thing about bringing back Sarah Jane is that we thought of a great story. That's always the most important thing, right? Never mind the past and never mind what it means to other generations, things like that. There's a great, great story to be told.
Action.
You've regenerated.
About half a dozen times since we last met.
You look incredible.
So do you.
What are you doing here?
UFO sighting. School gets record results. I couldn't resist. What about you?
Same.
I thought you'd died. I waited for you. You didn't come back. I thought you must have died.
I lived. Everyone else died.
Scream.
Okay. Now I can.
Cut.
The anniversary episode of The Five Doctors aside...
Quick, over there.
Sarah Jane was last seen being dumped off in Croydon. Or was that Aberdeen?
If you want a contender for the saddest scene in Doctor Who, it is Sarah Jane leaving.
You're a good girl, Sarah.
Oh, look, it's too late apologising. Now everything's packed. I've got to go.
She doesn't want to go. He doesn't want her to go. But he can't see any way around it.
I've had the call from Gallifrey. So I can't take you with me. You've got to go.
Humans aren't allowed there.
You're playing one of your tricks on me. Just trying to make me stay.
No. I've received the call. And as a Time Lord, I must obey.
Absolutely is heartbreaking. And then she's gone. If there was ever a companion the Doctor would want to meet again, would want to pick up the pieces, would want to say a proper goodbye, if you watch that scene, it's definitely Sarah Jane.
This isn't Hillview Road. I bet it isn't even South Croydon. You know it.
One of the things about the Doctor is that he goes through life picking people up and moving on, you know, and that's never really examined in the show.
Did I do something wrong? Because they never came back for me. You just... dumped me.
Like an old girlfriend, you know, they split up. They, you know, the Doctor dumped her. And years later, they meet up again. And where are they left with that? And how does that affect you if you've been travelling through time and space?
You took me to the furthest reaches of the galaxy. You showed me supernovas, intergalactic battles, and then you just dropped me back on Earth. How could anything compare to that?
Well, I guess that's how it would be, you know, if you'd had all these extraordinary experiences and then it stopped.
You could have come back.
He doesn't reflect and he doesn't look back.
I couldn't.
Why not?
Sarah Jane's quite bitter. She's not particularly pleased about how her life turned out.
He really did love her, but he really has never been back to see her.
I waited for you. I missed you.
And then you have to ask yourself, why? Why does he live a life like that?
Oh, you didn't need me. You were getting on with your life.
You were my life.
If you imagine that as a story about a man going from woman to woman to woman, it's a very interesting emotional story.
Who's she?
Rose, Sarah Jane. Sarah Jane, Rose.
Hi. Nice to meet you. You can tell you're getting older. Your assistants are getting younger.
I'm not his assistant.
No. I get you tired.
As ever with any story, you're sort of looking at what the Doctor and Rose's relationship is. So some new slant or some new light on that story, and it's hard to think of new elements of story, and so Sarah Jane brings in jealousy, which we've never had before.
I don't mean to be rude or anything, but who exactly are you?
Sarah Jane Smith. I used to travel with the Doctor.
Oh, he's never mentioned you.
It is an interesting situation when Rose meets Sarah Jane. It is, I think, as Mickey, I think, says.
Oh, mate, the missus and the ex. Welcome to every man's worst nightmare.
Which puts the Doctor in a slightly awkward position at times, and it's certainly a very difficult position for Rose, who hadn't, I don't think until this point, really thought this through, that there were other ones before her.
How many of us have there been travelling with you?
Does it matter?
Yeah, it does, if I'm just the latest in a long line.
As opposed to what?
In school reunion, there's the realisation that possibly life with the Doctor was not forever.
I thought you and me were... I obviously got it wrong.
The journey that Rose is taking, Sarah has already done.
I've met ghosts.
Robots. Lots of robots.
Slovene in Downing Street. Daleks. Met the Emperor.
I think that's one of the great things of the episode, watching how Rose copes with us.
Gas mask zombies.
Real living dinosaurs.
Real living werewolf.
Thief. Loch Ness monster.
Seriously?
It's a little bit childish, it's funny, it's a bit Sex and the City. Oh. Actually, when Toby was writing it, we kept on saying to him, write it like Sex and the City, write it like Samantha and Carrie fighting over one man.
I sort of imagine them kind of like sitting over a Caesar salad and kind of, you know, slightly bitchy with each other. And then the sort of all kind of politeness falls away and they start actually genuinely being rude to each other. And then this leads to them bitching about the doctor.
Does he still stroke bits of the tart?
Yeah, he does. I'm like, do you two want to be alone?
By the end, actually, they're thick as thieves.
How's it going?
But you've also got this really quite complicated and sometimes quite dark emotional journey that these characters are going through as well. And of course it's great for Rose too, because she's having to think, is that my future? Is that what I'm being left with?
I've been to the year 5 billion, right, but this, now this has really seen the future. You just leave us behind. Is that what you're going to do to me?
No, not to you.
What Sarah Jane does for Rose in the story is to give her a new perspective on life for the Doctor, and this time it's not necessarily a good perspective, it's the fact that this cannot last.
But Sarah Jane, you were that close to her once, and now you never even mention her.
This is the Doctor, this is what he does, he will go on.
As the series goes on, we see what Rose's resolve is, to how to deal with that.
You can spend the rest of your life with me, but I can't spend the rest of mine with you. I have to live on, alone.
Life for the Time Lord cannot be forever, that he will outlive you no matter what.
That's the curse of the Time Lord.
I think that's the most unsettling thing for Rose. Not so much the realisation that there were people before her, but the fact that it's quite easy for the Doctor just to shed those memories and move on.
But in the meantime, the Doctor has problems of his own with the arrival of Mr. Finch, the ultimate bat out of hell.
The first scene we did together was that scene at the swimming pool where you know, the two characters, it's the big high noon moment, it's the big confrontation. I'd never met Tony Head before. Obviously, I've seen him in a million things. And often the characters he plays are often rather kind of stern, slightly patrician characters. And he himself is so unlike that. He's so friendly and so... he's really good fun. And then, of course, he turns it on as Mr. Finch, and he's dripping malevolence.
No parents. No one to miss you. Come inside. It's nearly time for lunch.
I mean, having Anthony Head to play the headmaster of Finch was just inspired.
What is it now, Mr. Finch?
I am now a grillotine. We're having an early lunch. I think I sound a little bit like a hair product.
He's a sinister creature in this. You know bad is going to happen.
Action!
Finch is wonderfully and supremely arrogant, and he comes from a warrior race, so he's not fazed by this rather thin dude. Who's stepping up to the plate.
Who are you?
My name is Brother Lassar. And you?
The Doctor.
Just like gunslingers at either end of the bar.
Since when did krillotines have wings?
It's been our form for nearly 10 generations now. Our ancestors invaded Bessan. The people there had some rather lovely wings. They made 1 million widows in one day.
Totally aware of each other's power, history, ambition, and the danger.
And now your shape's human.
A personal favourite, that's all.
And you get a frisson between those two. And that carries through the episode very powerfully.
My brothers remain bat form. What you see is a simple morphic illusion. Scratch the surface and the
true Krillitane lies underneath.
When I'm ready for it, I choose to sort of go up to him and taunt him a little.
And what of the Time Lords? I always thought of you as such a
pompous race.
Ancient, dusty senators.
So frightened of change. And
chaos.
He's obviously relishing it. And it's wonderful to act against because, you know, you have to come up to match that.
They're all but extinct. Only you.
Villains are always fun. There's always got to be some reason why they're villainous, not just, you know, they're not just pure evil for the sake of it, because, you know, who cares? You know, and it's nice with something like this where there is an animalistic thing kind of added to it that you can play a little without going widely over the top.
This plan of yours, what is it?
You don't know.
That's why I'm asking.
Well, show me how clever you are. Work it out.
If I don't like it, then it will stop.
Fascinating.
What you get there off Anthony Head round that swimming pool is perfect pitch.
Your people were peaceful to the point of indolence. You seem to be something new.
It's so well judged. David's very glittering at the centre of the screen. Very hard to match him, and Anthony Head absolutely does it.
Would you declare war on us, Doctor?
I'm so old now. I used to have so much mercy.
When someone's that powerful and that crazed, it's great to act opposite.
You get one warning. That was it.
But we're not even enemies. Soon, you will embrace us.
Once they've discovered that they are each other's match, as it were, it's from then on, it's a dash to the finish line, really.
Well, next time we meet, you will join with me. I promise you.
That was fab. That was I let better. It go on because it was the best yet by on every department. Terrific, thank you.
At least there's the return of one old friend to lighten the mood.
K9!
It's a robot dog.
Rose Tyler, Mickey Smith, allow me to introduce K9. Well, K9 Mark III, to be precise.
The most fun you could possibly have with a robot and with a dog.
Ooh, what's a nasty lady done to you?
It's like it's not as messy as a dog.
Ooh.
It's not as boring as a robot. Two brilliant words put together to make something even better.
We'll take that tin thing as well.
I am not made of tin.
I mean, the thing about K9, it's an easy thing to take the mickey out of.
We are not alone.
What do you say?
I don't know.
Which is a faintly ridiculous point of view, I think, because the idea is so much fun. But I do like the fact that the script actually acknowledges that, and Mickey has that reaction to it, and Rose has that reaction to it slightly. They are laughing at a robot dog, which saves their lives in the end and shuts them up because they're wrong, because he's brilliant.
Why does he look so disco?
Oi! Coming, mistress.
Good boy, K9.
Oh, be quiet, K9.
Bless you.
I'd just seen K9 for the first time. He was sort of zipping around on set. They were kind of testing him out.
Woof, 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 woof.
He's bigger than I thought he was going to be. It's the same shell, so he's the same size as he always was. I thought he was smaller. The only slight disappointment is that John Leeson, who does the voice, isn't here.
Action!
You'll be trapped inside.
That is correct.
I can't let you do that.
I regret there is no alternative.
He's having to put the voice back in post-productions, which is a little disappointing.
It was like meeting an old friend, but, you know, he sounds pretty much the same. His vocal cords haven't changed very much.
I have capacity for only one shot, Master. For maximum impact, I must be stationed directly beside the vat.
But you'll be trapped inside.
That is correct.
I was absolutely astonished to be asked back, because I'd imagined K9 had been well pensioned off. I can't let you do that.
I regret. There is no alternative.
But the only sad thing, of course, when you're working this way, is that fans will come to me and say, what was it like working with David Tennant or Billy Piper or whatever? And I'll say, I haven't the foggiest idea. Goodbye, old friend.
Goodbye, Master.
I just came to a little studio, did the voices, wrapped it all up. There we are. You good dog.
Affirmative.
The way things looked on screen, and certainly the way I was directed this afternoon,
Everything fell into place. It was just the same as it was before, which is lovely.
Making his debut in 1977, K-9 rapidly became the Doctor's best friend, even earning his own series, K-9 and Company. Only to be put down after one episode.
Every sci-fi series had to have a robot. So kind of, in a sense, Doctor Who was following the pack. But I think with K-9, they did the usual sort of Doctor Who twist, that sort of incredibly British thing of inventing a robot, but kind of knowing it looked a bit rubbish.
Will he be all right?
I don't know.
When the tin dog was on set, that would just cause enormous hold-ups, enormous problems. So you can see why people who work with K-9 maybe weren't very fond of him. But actually, you know, the audience, I think, always loved him. Well, the audience who had a sense of humour.
I'm going to turn you into scrap yet, are we, Romana?
Make sure, John, I like.
Back on set, K-9 is ready to be a hero once again.
We're doing a scene here where Mickey runs out of the school and tries to get K-9 working because we need to break into the school to save the Doctor and Rose.
One more rehearsal then, please.
Action!
Come on. I need some help. Come on.
Systems restarting.
K-9 did get a bit of ear damage in the scene. He's not used to the physical activity we have to put in.
You broke K-9.
You know you're
not. No, I didn't. K-9 was broken.
K-9's ear.
I would never break that dog. Luckily, he was all right after 5 minutes. The guy that was helping him out came and tweaked his ear and it was all better. And he's fine now. He's fine now.
Should we shoot that then, please?
Roll, please.
Action.
Help.
System restarting. All primary drives functioning.
You're working, okay. No time to explain. We need to get inside the school. Do you have, like, I don't know, a lockpicking device?
We are in a car.
Maybe a drill attachment?
We are in a car.
Fat lot of good you are. Wait a second. We're in a car. Get back!
And cut.
We had a good little scene there. He got a bit diva-ish, annoyed. I had to conk him on his head. You know, he did his job, and, you know, he's in for one episode, so I can tolerate the diva behaviour. K-9? Yeah, he's fine now. He's good.
But there's one new arrival to Doctor Who about to meet a sticky end.
This afternoon, I will be getting glooped.
Can somebody tell me about the spray into the gunk, please?
It will not be affecting me as it will be affecting some of my accomplices.
Just want to remind you, you are incredibly powerful alien creatures.
They're all going to get burned rather unpleasantly.
This is where B camera's going to play quite heavily as well for our moments of splatting.
I have a feeling that it'll be probably fairly messy.
Action!
Let me find him. Eat him if you must, but bring me a spray. The little dog with a nasty bite. Not so powerful now, are you?
Bang!
It's everyone's destiny to be glooped by something one time in their life. And the Krillitanes are glooped by their own oil.
You bad dog.
Affirmative.
My only concern about the scene with the green goo was there wasn't enough green goo. I'd have slimed him even more quite happily.
I was third in line. I got a fair spraying. I actually found it in my hair, which was fairly unpleasant. But, you know, what you do for art.
He made a mess, didn't he?
And actually, therein hangs a tale. I think we're all fairly greasy from the start. It's a fitting end.
Amidst the celebrations, the Doctor has one task left that he's been putting off for years.
In the history of Doctor Who, there's very few big goodbye scenes.
Grandfather!
Goodbye, Susan. Goodbye, my dear.
The Doctor never likes goodbyes. The Doctor always tries to slip off before the story's actually ended.
Every-
time we say goodbye.
You know, he knows he'll probably never see these people again. They'll die eventually.
Goodbye, Jamie.
He'll just go on and on and on and on.
Goodbye, Jerry.
Goodbye, Doctor. Will we ever meet again?
Doctor.
Yes.
I will miss you.
I'll miss you too, Savage.
Goodbye. It's a funny thing, you know, even with his closest friends, he can't ever bring himself to say a proper farewell to them.
Goodbye, Doctor.
Oh, it's not goodbye.
You say it, please, this time. Say it.
That is pure emotion. That's where one of the moments where you're letting the sentiments of a scene absolutely come to the surface and say, well, you would. This is a great big emotional moment. You would do the hugs here and the big hug, farewell to the Doctor. It's like all of that has been pent up in Sarah Jane for decades, absolute decades. She gets her chance to say goodbye properly.
Goodbye. My Sarah Jane.
She needs closure. She needs to move on. And it's all very well him always saying, hey, everything can be fine, you know. But it can't always for a human, and she is going to age and die, and she needs the end of that part of her life, especially now having seen he's carried on with her replacement.
It takes a meeting like this. It takes someone like Sarah Jane, who was so important to him, to come into his life, to actually drag that out of him. And she does make him say the big goodbye. She actually forces it out of him. Standing in that sunlit park, it's beautiful, sunny and romantic and gorgeous, and for once in his life he can't say no and loves it. I think he loves that moment, the Doctor, but nonetheless turns and goes.
Every time we say goodbye.
He's always, always, always got to move on, and she knows that and lets him do it in the end.
And we give you another chance to see Doctor Who here tomorrow at 7. Next, though, it's The Apprentice.